Okay, welcome. All, so I think now you should all be experts in basic C and C++. Is that correct? Or are there people who still think that pointers are this mysterious thing that causes them problems all the time? If it does, then we can give you lots of homeworks to practice that, and we'll help you with it. But what I want to do today is two things. The first is I want to teach you what the compiler does when you compile a program, and we want to discuss what is the preprocessor and how to use it. And then we'll discuss build systems. And with build systems, I don't mean Lego. So the first thing we'll do is we'll just run a program, and we want to see what happens. Let me just switch here, and let me just look at the program that we have here. It's called hello.c, we had that previously. Or let's just write the program, hello.c, and what we do here is we include the IOStream library, and we write our main program, and we're going to just write hello students. Now I'm going to compile it, C++ hello.c. It compiles, I get a program called a.out. I'm going to run it, and it prints hello students. Magic. So what happened behind the scenes? What happened, we can see that if the GNU compiler, we tell the --- verbose option and the --safe temps. So let's try that. Oops, it doesn't want to switch. Okay, now we're here. So let's do C++, --- verbose, --safe temps, hello.c. Oops, and it printed lots of things. It's really verbose. And when one looks in here closely, it tells you, think, what is the compiler? What is it doing? And when you go through that, that is just configured with those options. And where is it really doing something? Here. It calls the C++ compiler, and it passes in an option --e. And the input is our file hello.c, and it produces an output with -o. It writes the output to hello.ii. Who knows what that hello.ii is? We'll look at it. It's no problem. Then after that, it again does something. It compiles something. It calls a compiler, and here. It again calls the compiler, and the input file is now the hello.c, and the output file is a hello.s. And then it calls a program called as, the assembler, and it produces an output file called hello.o. And then it calls a program here called collect2, that's the linker, and the input is the hello.o and a few other things, and the output is written into a.out. So it's a few steps that are going on here. And let's look at the files it produced. I now have a file hello.c, we know that, and have a file hello.ii and a file hello.s. Let's look at the files. If nobody knows what the hello.ii is, then let's look at it. And OK, it's text we can read. And it seems to be lots of comments and things in there. And there's some text in here, but that's not text we wrote. Or did we type that? When you go to the end of the program, which is about 16,000 lines below the end, we find our code. So that included lots of stuff into the program that's been compiled. And what that has done, that was just this include statement we wrote on top that just included that file in it. And this is now the file that has been preprocessed that will now be compiled. What do we get when we compile it? The next file was the hello.s. Let's look at that hello.s file. And who knows what that is? Oh, that is the hello students. At least that's the string we had. Yeah? That's the machine code was the example. So can the machine run this code? No, this is text. This is fast to read. That's the assembler language. I have a move, a push, a sub, and so on. So these are the statements, which is the text form, which is the human readable form of the machine code. So the compiler produces this the assembler file, and then the assembler comes the AS command, and that translates that assembler file into the object, into the machine code, the hello.o. Okay, and that we can't read, so that's probably for the machine. But if I'm not mistaken, yes, in here I find hello students, so we still have our string in there at least. So this was probably our code, but this is nothing I can do. Now, what is this hello.o? Is that the program that can run? Let's try to run it. No. Permission denied. Now, I could give it an execute permission, but that's probably not a smart idea. So this is just my part of the program. But it's still missing the standard libraries. So next, the linker takes this, plus all of the system library, and it makes the final program that we run. There's this a.out here. Okay, that's also something we cannot understand. But let's look for the string hello. Yes, the string hello students is still in there. So this is probably our program, and when we run it, then it actually prints something. So there are a few steps being done here. And the first step is the preprocessor. The processes all of the preprocessing directives and makes one pure C++ file that is then being compiled into the assembly language file, the hello.s, and that's a text file which is human readable. And one statement in C++ might give you many statements in the assembly language. And then the assembler comes and takes that file and translates it one-to-one, one statement into one statement of the machine code. And then I still have to link that against the system libraries. And that gives me the final program. So today, I want to discuss with you first the C++ preprocessor and what it does. And those commands they start with a hash mark. These commands are not C++. This is the preprocessor language. That's a separate program that runs on your source file before the compiler ever sees it. And all it does is just manipulates your input text. It doesn't know anything about the language. That's nice because that means you can use it also for Fortran programs, for Java programs, for Python programs. You can use it for your text files you write, your LaTeX sources, your emails, and so on. It is just a text manipulation tool. And it is the commands that start with that hash mark. So let's look at the first one, define. Define simply defines a macro. So hash define the XXX hello just means that wherever the string 3x appears, replace it by the string hello. We can. This is useful, but it can be dangerous. If I say, for example, define cout cin, then you replace all occurrences of cout by cin, and people will be totally confused. So be careful, and one useful convention is to just use all capital letters only for such macros. Then you know that is such a preprocessor macro. You can also give it arguments like here, the sum macro that takes two arguments, negative A and B, should just be replaced by the text A plus B. So then the text sum sum of your 3 and 4 gets replaced by the text 3 plus 4. It's not calculated, it just replaces the text sum of 3 and 4 by the text 3 plus 4. What is useful is that you can define macros on the command line with the minus D option, or it's a slash D option on Windows. And then you have the name of the macro and then equal the value if you want to give it a value. You can also define a macro being empty, just here like the YYY. That's just defined, but it maps to the empty string. Where would you use that? One example could be you want to compile a program that uses my name many times. But if I compile it and I want my name used, if you compile it, you want your name used, and so you can make name a macro. There's also, there's also undef. Undef undefines the macro. So after the undef, the text is no longer replaced. So here, I define the triple X to be hello, then I print triple X, that changes it to hello, then I undef XXX, and the next time it's not replaced. You can also do that on the command line with the minus capital U option. That's like an undef. And now let's look at the first examples. And on most Unix machines, you can run just the preprocessor by giving the minus E option, or you run the full program with the minus save temps option, and then look at the II file. So here we have two examples we want to look at, the pre-1 and pre-2 for the two preprocessor examples. So, and let's just look at this pre-1.c code. Where do we have it? Yeah, pre-1.cpp. Pre-1.cpp. Or let me open it like this, then you can see it better. This defines the macro scale to be 10, and it defines the macro min to be be a function that returns the smaller of the values. And now I have a function scale here, and that returns the min of scale times x and 0. So what happens when we run that through the preprocessor? C++ minus e pre1.cpp. Then we see the scale has been replaced by 10, and the min has then, okay, and then the min of 10 times x and 0 has been replaced by the by 10 times x less than 0, question mark, 10 times x colon 0. So it just replaces the text. We also have an example pre-2. The pre-2 is just a function that returns scale times x, and the scale factor I need to set. So if I just run that through the preprocessor, C++ minus e pre2.cpp, I get just return scale times x, because scale is just scale, right? But now I can define a macro called scale. Minus d scale equal 5. And then there's 5 times x. Then I can be nasty. Minus d return equal input. Minus d double equal crash, and we get something like that, right? Total nonsense. This doesn't care anything about C++. It just replaces text. Okay, so where can we use it in a smart way? The first is I can use it to decide between options in the program. Sometimes I want to compile it in some way, and sometimes I want a different code. Like in debug mode, I want this. In the release mode, I want that. On Linux, I do this. On Windows, I do that. On Monday, I do this. On Tuesday, I do that. Okay, that might not be as useful, but the rest is. And let's look at an example, pre-3. Pre-3.c, CPP. Here I have a safe square root function, which normally returns just the std square root, but if I define the macro debug, then I want to check. So here I write if def debug, then I add the code if x less than 0 print to the standard error stream, but the problem is square root. This might not be the best way of handling problems, and I'll teach you later on how to properly check for conditions, but this at least tells you there's a problem somewhere. But we don't want to do the checks once we know the program is really debugged and safe and now it should run fast, and then we don't want that code in there. So what are the options? The first option is once I know it works, I just remove those lines completely from the code. That's fine, then it's fast from then on. But if you find the problem again, you might want to come back and check again, then you might actually have to just type all that test code again. So it's safer to put the test code into an if-def statement, leave it in there, but it's not being compiled if you don't define the macro debug. We can look at that. If I just do C++ minus E pre-3.cpp, it just returns the square root, and the rest is just empty lines, because the macro debug wasn't defined. But if I do minus D debug, now it's defined. Now the code is in there. So you can choose which version you want to have at compile time. So I don't want you to ever remove debug code that might still be useful, but I want you to use the if-def around it, did like I've shown here. The next is, I'm going to teach you about standard conforming C++ and the C++ standard. And in an ideal world, every compiler would implement the standard perfectly, and no compiler would be buggy. And then in an ideal world, you would just write perfect code, and it would just work. So just like you don't always write bug-free code, the compiler vendors does also sometimes write buggy compilers, or misimplement some features, or add some extra features. Let's not call them bugs. And the same code might not work on all compilers, and then you might want to use some workarounds. And you can do that using macros, because every compiler typically specifies the macros for the compiler type, the platform, be it Linux, macOS, Windows, the compiler version, and so on. And then using if-defs and so on, you can check which version of the code you write for which platform. There's also the if statement. And the if can check equations. And it can check whether things are defined. Like here, instead of an if-def, I do an if not defined, finding a GNU C, I print it's a non-GNU compiler. Else if is the elif, if the version is less than 2, and so on, or if it's bigger than 2, or if it's 2, or if it's bigger than 2, or bigger than 3, or if it's bigger than 4, and so on, then you have the various versions of the code that you need. So you can make the code dependent on the compiler and the platform. One homework for you is trying to find out which macros does your compiler define on your machine. The main page can tell you about that, or some option in the compiler, just try that. Then I can also do error messages. Like if I have something that only runs on Windows, then I write the if not defined Windows error, get a Windows machine. If defined Windows errors, I don't like Windows, get Linux or a Mac. Or I might just know that this only works with a GNU compiler, because I make use of special features of GNU that are not in the standard and that no other compiler uses, and then I check for that, and I write a sensible message like, this program requires the GNU compilers. And let's just see if we have a nice example for that. We have the pre4.cpp. If and def define me, error, please add minus d define me to the command line. Let me just try to compile that. C++ -c pre4.cpp. I get an error message, and the error message is, error, please add minus d define me to the command line. So I can force an error message that tells me what I should do. Now it compiles. Or I check for a feature, or the compiler version, and so on. But now we come to the more useful for things that you will need in every single program, typically, and that is the include statement. The include, for example, the include IOStream here, just looks for a file called IOStream and just copies the contents of that file verbatim into my source file. And we have examples again. Let's look at the pre5.cpp. The pre5.cpp just does an include of pre1.cpp. So this should just copy the pre1 file into it. Let's try to compile it. pre5.cpp, and here we have our program pre1 in there with all the macros replaced. We just copied that program into it. Then we have the pre6.cpp. It just includes IOStream. Did you ever wonder what that does? We can just run it. Yeah. And it gives you about 16,000 lines of lots of function and class definitions, that is the library that has the C out, the C in, and how you actually print things and so on in there. It just copies that library, boom, into your source file. Now let's look at the pre7.cpp. The pre7.cpp, I want to include the file called file.hpp, and I have that file.hpp here. No, I don't have it here. Where do I have it? I have that file HPP in my directory include here. It's somewhere else. It's not in my current directory, but it's in this directory called include. If I now try to call the preprocessor on pre7.cpp, it will not work because there's an error. There's no such file as a file.hpp. What am I missing? I just never told the compiler where the file is. So I need to tell the compiler where to look for the files that I want to include. That's what I do with the minus capital I option. Minus capital I and then the path to the file, minus I include. And now it works. Now it includes this file.hpp, and there's some function square in here that returns x times x. So with the minus capital I specify the include path, namely where should the compiler look for the files that I want to include. Why did I need that for the IOStream library? For the IOSTM library, I used the Angular brackets, and with those, it is looking in the standard system path, so the compiler knows where the standard libraries are installed, and it just looks at the standard places. That finds IOSTM. And now we come to the first useful thing where you will actually use it in your code, and you will use that for this week's homework. I work near the exercises, because I often want to split my program into multiple source files. Why do I want to split it into multiple source files? Does anybody have an idea? Or would you ever split your program into multiple source files? No? You would split it or not?
Yes.
Yes. Okay. You please use the microphone and tell me. Okay. Turn it on and tell me why you want to split it.
Because it is more readable.
It's more readable when you split it. Why?
Well, I can put some. I don't know. If I have a large code, let's say 300,000 lines of code. And if I want to look for something, it's impossible to find it in one file.
Okay, so, it just helps you to split it when it's a big code that you can find it, and you don't have to go through 300,000 lines of code and look for it. But you have separate files. But then with a good search function, like let's say you use Google search or Bing search on it, and then you can also find the things in your code. Is there another advantage of splitting it? Yes? Turn it on, please.
So you can use diff.
Yes, so you can reuse parts of the program. If you write the file and you use that later somewhere else, you don't have to copy and paste the parts of the file over to the new one. But you can just reuse it by reusing that file again in the new program. Yes, that makes sense, because one thing is I never want you to copy and paste. Yes, we asked in the first week if you use copy and paste for version control, but that was the wrong answer. You might have used it in the past, you should not use it anymore in the future. Never repeat yourself. Yes. Never repeat yourself. Okay, it should apply to me. But it's really so important that I had to repeat it now. So, which means don't copy it. Don't copy it, because then you have two versions to maintain. You have the same functions in two projects. You improve it in one, the other is still the old one. You find a bug in one, you have to go to all your 20 other projects and fix the bug there. It's much easier if you have the code only in one place. Don't copy and paste. Don't duplicate. So, there's another advantage. If you have a 300,000 line file and it's heavily templated C++ code, it might take 1 hour to compile. Now you change one line. You wait another hour to compile. Or you split it into 100 smaller files. You change one line in one file, only that file needs to be recompiled, and then they just get linked together again. It really makes sense to split it into pieces. So let's split it into pieces. Let's say we have a main program here that should print the square of 5, and we split it by having a separate file with the function square, where we calculate the square because I might use that many times, and then have the main program where I want to use the function square. But if I just write this part, stdcout square of 5, it doesn't know that there's a function called square, because in the file main.c, the function square is not defined. What can I do? One solution is I could just go into this main program here, main.c, and in there I declare a function square, right? Double square of double. And then in my other file called square.c, I also have the function double square of double x. But now I have a potential for a huge problem, because what if I change my function square and now uses long doubles. By the function long double square of long double. Then in the file square.c, there's a function square that takes a long double, but in my main, I might have declared it as double. It's just not consistent. And the other thing is, never repeat yourself. I don't want to declare the function every program where I use it. I don't want to write here, there's a function square that I have, there's a function square that I have, there's a function square that I have. Told you, never repeat yourself. And so what we're going to do is we're going to put the function declaration, the statement here, double square of double, that there exists a function called square. I'm going to put that into a so-called header file, square.h. And that header file, I'm going to include that in my main program, main.c. And that way the compiler now knows here that there's a function square. And I'm going to include the same header in my function square.c, so that then the compiler also there knows that the function square should take a double. And that way I have declared the function only once, in one location in square.h, and it's consistent over all places where I use it. So I put the declarations of the functions that exist into the file square.h. The other option would have been I could just have included square.c. But that's not good, because then in every program where I use it, I'm compiling that whole thing again, and I still end up with my 300,000 lines of code that take 1 hour to compile. So I want to compile it separately. I compile the square.c function separately and the main.c function separately. And then I'm going to separately compile them. So let's look at that here. I have my main.cpp. Let's look at it with VI, then you see it. That includes IOStream, includes the square.negative.hpp, and then prints the square 5. I have the square.cpp file. Yeah. That includes the same header file and then finds the function square. And I have my header file square.hpp that just declares the function. Now I'm going to compile my file main.cpp, and that gives me an error. That gives me the error, square of double is not found, link error. Why do I get that? Because when I just use the compiler, then before, right, we have the preprocessor, we have the compiler, we have the assembler and the linker. So it's trying to link it all together, and it doesn't know the function square. So what we're going to do is we just do C++ minus C main.cpp that only compiles and doesn't link. And now we find here a file called main.o. The main has been compiled. Then we do the same with square, C++ minus C, square.cpp. And now we also have a square.o here. And then in the last step, we're going to take the main.o and the square.o, and we're going to link them together. When this is a duplicate symbol x. That's okay. Maybe we should use it. Let's try. Do we have an X defined somewhere here? Let's try a different compiler. Yeah, that's what I tried before. I'm just trying to change compilers now. Yeah, you see, there are always compiler bugs. Duplicate symbol. Underscore X. I don't get that. Let's see which compiler I'm actually using. Let's go to a different one. No, same. Okay, I have to debug that in the break. Because it's no longer allowing me to compile it. Okay, we'll figure that out in the break. I can't even compile the two. Oh, it was here. Include HP. Okay, see, I found something here. The index. Yeah. That's the wrong one. That should include square.hpp. Now it works. No, it should work. Square.hpp, double square. No, that should include anything. Okay, C++ main dot minus C. Minus CPP. Now I'm going to link them together, the main dot O and the square dot O. Okay, what happened was that last year I added something to show problems that can happen and I left it in there. Version controller should have rolled back. So now I've linked it together and now I can run it and it should print 25. It prints 25, the square of 5. So it works. Yeah, and now this code is dangerous, and you saw one of the dangers already. There was some duplicate symbol at the link stage, but we can also have such a problem at the compile stage. And to look at that, we look at another example. And the problem will be, what if you include a file twice? Is the problem if you include the file twice? If my library or my square function includes the file IOStream and my main includes the file IOStream, then I can say, yes, yes, there's a problem. You shouldn't do that. You should never include the file twice. But what if another file you include already includes the IOStream? How should you know? Hey, you might try and you learn it once, but what if that changes and then suddenly you need to include it, then it will not work again. So what one then does is let's look at the example first. The guard.cpp, I'm including the file inkle.hpp twice. When I compile that with minus e, then we see it just says twice the statement int x and the int x. If we're going to compile that, then it will tell me it has in inkle.hpp in line 1, there's an error, we have redefined int x, which has been previously defined in inkle.hpp line 1. Say, hey, but that's the same line, but then you see it has been included twice. So to avoid that, we add something called an include guard. We go to this inkle.hpp, and we're going to do here an if def, an if not defined ifndef. We call that file age, let's call it file hpp, is not defined, or inkle hpp, that should be something that is this unique to the file, so it's best to give it the file name. If that macro is not defined, and the first time I do it, it's not defined yet, then I'm going to define the macro, then I have the int x, and then I do an end if. So what happens now? The first time I include it, the macro is not defined. I'm going to define it and then have my header. The next time I include it, it's already defined, and so I'm going to skip it. And now, when I do the minus e, you see it's in there only once. The second time is empty. And when I just compile the thing, then now it works. There's no more problem. So that's the main use of define. There's one other macro like, and that's the macro ndebug. Ndebug is a macro you should define if you don't want any debug statement in it. And the one place where it occurs is the header csert. Csert defines a macro called assert. And if ndebug is defined, then you don't want any debug statements, then this will not do anything. But if the macro is not defined, then if the expression in there is false, it will abort and print the message. So let's say we had the square root function. The square root function should check whether the number of which you take the square root is really positive. Then you can put in there a statement to assert x larger than equals 0. And if that's not the case, it will abort and tell you that that was violated. And we can try it because we have another example for this. So let's look at the assert.cpp. That's this checked square root. I'm going to assert that x is really greater than equals 0. Let me compile my program, assert.cpp, and I'm going to run it. I enter the number 4, and the square root is 2. Fine. I'm going to enter the number minus 4, and it triggers assertion failed. That's the statement that failed. And it tells you it's the function checked square root in that file at that line, so I know exactly where the problem occurred. So that's a very useful tool to check for conditions. In your Simpson integration program, you should check that the number of intervals is not 0. You need at least one interval, for example. It should also not be negative. But if we compile the same thing, now it should be really fast, and I don't want debug statements, so I define ndebug. And if I'm going to run it now and enter minus 4, it just prints NaN, not a number. It doesn't check anymore. It just runs through. So then we split now the simple program we had that printed the square of 5 into two files, a file main.o and the file square.o. But now we have our 300,000 line program, and we split it into 300 shorter files. And 100 of those files we want to reuse somewhere else. So now I have to compile all those 100 files separately elsewhere, and I have to link them. I have to list a long line of 100,000 files always. And I'm going to use those same 100 files. And I'm going to use the same 100 files in many projects. Then you say, okay, it's really ugly to always have to link 100 files, so let me put it back together into one source file. No, that's not what you want, but you can link those objects files together into a library. So a library is just a file that contains many object files in it. And if you want to make a static library, then on Unix systems, the command is ar, that's the archive tool, and then you write ruc, that is created, updated, and replaced functions, and then you have the library name, libtest.a, and then you list all of the object files that should go into it, like here the square.o. We just make a square library now here, and we call it libtest.a. Yes?
Do we have to link the files every time we change something in the C++ code?
Every time you change something in the C++ code, you have to recompile that file. And then the AR tool allows you to just replace a single file. So let's say you have the libtest A, and that has a square.o and a cube.o and many other files. And then if you just change the square.o file, then you just have to run that command with square.o. But yes, you have to again put the new object file into the library. So you have to remember, whenever I change something in a header file, I have to recompile all the source files that include it, and after I've recompiled all the source files that include it, then I have to update all the archive where those go, and I have to relink all the programs. That's the second hour today where we solve this problem. And then afterwards, I want to link it, and now I want to link the main against all the objects files in that library. And that is you link against that library by writing just minus L test. So when the library is called libtest.a, then you link against it with minus L test. So minus L test looks for a file called libtest.a. And where does it look for it? You can tell it with a minus capital L option where to look for your libraries. Like the minus I told you where to look for the include files. So we can try making a library here. And you will then do a library for your Simpson by saying ARIUC, let's call it libsquare.a, and we put in the square.o. And now I can compile my main.o, and that doesn't work because the square wasn't defined. One way was I could just add the square.o, but now we're going to just add our square library. But it doesn't find it because it didn't specify where, so it go minus capital L dot and defines where it is, and it's linked against it. So that means it whatever symbol it doesn't know, like the square function, it looks for it in the libraries and then links against it. You're going to do that for the Simpson. And then ideally what you should do is one person should write a main program, so you should pair up. You should share one repository or two, and you should link your code against the other person's library and check that it works. So we had that. Yeah, that we had. Yes, now there's so what that does is it does not link in all of the object files in the library, but only those functions which are missing. But the order here matters. If you link against two libraries, A and B, then it first looks for all things that are missing in A, links them in, and then whatever is still missing, it looks for in B. But if B now calls a function that's in A, then it will not work. So you have to watch out what is the order of the libraries. Then in the end, I want you to document your library. You all know that if somebody gives you code and it's not documented, you can't really use it until that person really tells you in person what to do, but that's not what is here kept usually happening. So I then want you to document your Simpson library. And first, you should write a short synopsis that tells you what are the functions or the types or the variables in this library. Then for each one, like for the functions, you should write what is the semantics. So what does it actually do? Then you should write the preconditions. What has to be satisfied in order to call the function, like the square root function, the number has to be positive. And then the postconditions, that is, are those things that you guarantee to be true if the preconditions were satisfied. Like for the square root, that actually after you call it with a number that was positive, what you get is the square root up to some round of errors. You should also mention what it depends on. Okay, this needs the square library from ETH, for example. Exceptions guarantees this will come later, and then maybe references to where Simpson has been defined and so on, or the Wikipedia page or something. How would that look like for our square library here? The synopsis is simple, that the header file square contains the function square, and that's just there's double square of double, that's just the function definition. The semantics of that is the function square calculates the square of x. Okay, that was pretty obvious, but square of x might also have drawn a square somewhere. precondition, you have to think about what do I need to have that it works. And in this case, the absolute value of the number has to be less than the square root of the maximum number that it can represent. If it's bigger than the square root of the maximum number, then the square will be infinite. So the precondition is that the number with which I call it is less than the square root of the largest number. Then the postcondition here, I say, okay, if that's the case, then what I give you is basically the true square within round of errors. And the way to test is that if I take the square root of it and subtract the absolute value, then the square root of the square should not differ by more than epsilon times the absolute value of the number from the number itself. So the square root of the square should basically be within round of errors the absolute value of the number. Dependencies, this library doesn't depend on anything, it's trivial. Now that is what I'm going to do later, inlining that. Let's make a break here, 10 minutes, and then continue. Then I tell you how to solve the problem of remembering how many files I had to change and update and recompile and relink and so on. 10 minutes break. So let's continue. The question was kind of how do I know what to do and what files to recompile and what files to relink, and that's the same as our poor robot here, who has to do many things on a day. He has to redraw a figure, to redraw the figure, has to recalculate the data, so that he first has to remember that he changed the program, so he has to recompile the program. Then he realizes that program needs a new version of Java, for which he will need his new graph tool, which also needs the new version of Java. Then he runs out of disk space, so he has to free up disk space. And he has to go shopping, he has to go to ETH, and he has to do this and that. So the question is, what do we have to do today, and in which order? We all know that problem. And so what we want to, but we want to now just look at those things and not at going shopping and so on. And one way, and this is a task at the top. I need to redraw a figure, and it depends on other tasks that have to be done before. And if you look at that, then you see you can do it by, for example, first freeing up disk space, then recompiling the stats program, then updating Java, recalculating the data, reinstalling the graph tool, and then redrawing the figure. So you have to find the right order in which to do things. It doesn't help you if after you changed a program source file, you relink the library and then you recompile the program file that goes into the library, but you have to do things in the right order. And we always have to remember what we have to do and in which order. And this we need often. When we have new data, we need to recalculate the statistics we have there. When the source file changes, we have to recompile the program. When we have new contents for a web page, we have to update the website and so on. There are things that depend on other things. And many of those things we have to do multiple times and many times. And it's hard to really keep track of what depends on what's up to date and what isn't, like which program to have to recompile, and so on. And then anything that is worth repeating, so anything that you do more than once is also worth automating. Because at least after you've done it 5 or 6 times, then you think, why do I always have to sit here for 10 minutes and type in the same stupid commands? So to solve that, we use the build manager to automate it. And the only thing we have to do is we have to describe in a file what depends on what. And how do we update things? And all the rest is done by the build manager. And we're going to use make here that was in many years ago by the internet, the Perlabs. And that's basically a programming language to describe dependencies and to describe how to update things. It's a very strange language. It's a cryptic language, it's an old language. It has no debugger, and it has some strange features. You need to know the Unix shell, but I think we learned about that. And then you can use it. And what we're going to use is we're going to look at writing a paper, because I want to show you that this tool is useful for more than just compiling programs. And so the example I'm going to use is we want to write a paper where when anything changes in the input files, then the fig in the paper gets updated automatically. So we have the paper .pdf file, which we create from a source file paper .tech using the PDF LaTeX command on that file. Then we have two figures. And the figures are created by a Python script from the summary data. And the summary data is created by another script or program from some source data files, from the raw data to the summary data to the figure and that into the paper. And if one of the files here changes, then I have to redo the summary, then I have to redo the figure, and then I have to typeset the paper again to have the right version of the paper. So, okay, we've done. But that's not all, because when you go through here, these are not the only dependencies. I call the script stats.py. So if that script changes, then I also want to update it. So it should also depend on stats.py. And the figures also depend on plot.py. When that script changes, the figure also has to be redone. And first, we need to check what version of the file is newer. How do you know how to easily check that? If you have a GUI, you can just go in there and type, okay, and look at it and sort it by date, and then you see what it is. If you use the shell, you can do ls, and you use the -t option that sorts it by date. So in this case here, it first shows the summary of the 1.dat and then figure 1.pdf. And that means that the data file is newer than the figure. That there's in the figure. I changed some things in there. So it's newer than the figure. And so I need to update it again. And the way I do that is I put into a make file. So I write a file that tells me how to create the figure 1.pdf. And what I put in there is first a comment, like that's the file hello.mkk, that's what starts with a hash mark. Then I put in there a rule. This rule here is, how do I make the figure 1.pdf? The figure 1.pdf text here, that's the target, that's what's going to be built. Then I do the colon, and then after that I put the prerequisites, that are those things that have to be, that have to exist and have to be up to the date in order to build it. And then down there, I do the action that I have to do. So this says, if you want to build figure 1.pdf, you need to have the summary 1.dat be up to date. And then you call the function .plot.py summary 1.dat figure 1.pdf. That's how you build it. What's very important, that shows how cryptic it is, This here is not a few spaces, this is one tab character. The action has to be prepended by a single tab character. If you put in 8 spaces, it will not work. If your editor replaces tabs by spaces, it will not work. So the makefile, this has to be a tab. That's one of the harder things to learn about make. And then we run it. I type make minus f, fhello.mk. That will then build that file. That will first check. And then it will build it. So this here will run. Plot.py summary 1.dat figure 1.pdf. And it runs, and then it makes the figure. Because in this case here now, the summary 1.dat was newer than the figure, so it runs. If I then run it again, nothing happens. Why does nothing happen? Because now the figure is newer than the prerequisite. I don't build it more than once. I just build it once. I only do it when it's needed. And that's why nothing is done. If you don't believe me, we can just go there and have something here. And have the hello.make. And let's just look at that hello.mk here. That's just the rule we had. And we're going to touch the summary 1.dat. And if I now do an ls minus lt, then you see summary 1.dat and the figure 1.pdf. Then you see the one is now and the other is from 2 days ago. Now I can do make minus f. What was it? It was hello.mk. Now it makes it. And I try the second time, and it's already up to date. That nothing is done. So it only does the actions that it has to do. Okay, that's different. This one shouldn't be here. So then, now we have the second figure. So I can put in 2 rules. Figure 1.pdf depends on summary 1.dat, and figure 2.pdf depends on summary 2.dat. Then I touch the dat files that it's updated. Now I force the figures to be redone. And I run it, and it just calls plot.py on summary 1.dat, figure 1.pdf. It updates figure 1, but it doesn't do figure 2. Do you know why? The reason is it only does the first rule in the make file. Unless you explicitly specify what to make, it only builds the first one. So make doesn't do anything else unless it's explicitly told to also build the second one. So I can type make minus f double dot make figure 2.pdf, and then that's being updated. That's one other thing to know. Unless you specify what it should update, it will only do the first target in the file. Now, that's not nice, because now I have to remember which figures do I have to build at all and so on. So the way around that is we introduce some phony target first, a target that doesn't do much, but it depends on other things. And because it doesn't exist, it's never up to date. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to write in the first line a target called all. And all doesn't exist. There's no file called all, so it can never be up to date. But all depends, I claim, on figure 1.pdf and on figure 2.pdf. If I now type make, then it sees that all doesn't exist, so it has to build it. And in order to build it, it needs to build figure 1.pdf and figure 2.pdf. And then it checks the two, and it updates those that are needed. So you just start with an all target where you list all things that it should build, and then this gets done. That's the all. And you can do make all that reveals all things. And you can also do something like make clean that removes everything. So we can try that again. We can touch all the source files, the .dot files, and I type make minus f, and then the make file, and then it will update both figures because both input files have changed, and it will do both because that all target the first one dependent on both. But the order is not guaranteed. It might do one first, or the other first, or the second first, or it might do the first one first, might do the second one first, it might do both in parallel. That's both possible. So for this dependency tree, one important thing is that something can be both a target and a dependency. Because all can depend on figure one, and figure one can depend on summary. So this can be a tree-like structure. This is a directed graph that must be acyclic. You're not allowed to have cycles in it. It can't be that x depends on z and z on y and y on x, because then you can't ever have it up to date because it's cyclic. So any graph is possible as long as it is acyclic. You can say, I want to build this, but first I have to go shopping. But you can't say, I want to go shopping, but first I have to study. But before I study, I have to eat. But before I eat, I have to go shopping. Before I go shopping, I have to study. Then you never get started. So it is not allowed to be cyclic. But now we go to the next level. Now I want to create the summary 1.dat in my files. And I'm going to just specify that summary 1.dat depends on data 1.dat and data 1.2.dat and data 1.3.dat. And to call it, I have a Python script here, stats.py, that I call with first the output put the file name summary 1.dat and then the list of input files. But how do I generalize that? How do I generalize that if I add another file, data14.dat? Yes, it's easy. If I do data14.dat, then I go back in there and I just add the file data14.dat and I add the file down there. And it gets cumbersome because if I forget to change that, that's a problem. And again, I don't want to repeat myself. And here I had to type data13.dat twice already. That's bad. My fingers are getting tired. Because I list those files twice. So how do we solve that? The way we solve that is we don't list this whole thing. But first I'm going to simplify it by not doing the summary 1.dat twice. And I do that by replacing the summary 1.dat by $at. What does $at mean? So I have two choices here. I can either use PowerPoint and then the transmission gets screwed up every time I use it, or use Keynote and then the things are just shifted around. So I think you just have to live that this should be a bit to the left. Just have to live with this. Or I can just try to fix it now. Let me fix it. Then that looks nice. So I have this $at that's available here. That's the target. And there is no more readable form. $at is the name that stands on the left. So I don't have to type summary 1.dat. I can just use $at. But still, I use the things on the right multiple times. They're still there twice. And I don't like that. What we can do for that is I can just write down there $caret. There's another cryptic thing I told you. It's a very cryptic language. The dollar caret is all the dependencies. Let me shift this over. So that's all. The dollar less than would be the first prerequisite. Dollar question mark would be all those that are out of date. So the most useful one is the dollar caret or the dollar left. That's the input files. So that way now it will work without me having to retype it twice. That solves one problem. It solves the problem that I can't just forget to write the data 1.4.dat in both lines. But I still have to edit manually. I have a data 1, 2, 3, 4, and so on. And that gets hard. But what I want to actually do is I want to use a star here. Here, like in the shell. That I can easily do by just typing here data 1 star dot dat. So it depends on all files that match this pattern. Now it's much, much shorter. But it's not. There's a problem with the fonts on this machine. Sorry. So that's just like a shell. Shell the wildcard. Now I must use the dollar the caret here because I can't type anymore this data 1, data 2, data 3, and so on. So just use the caret here. Now it builds it from as many files as we have. And that's what it looks like. If I want to make the figure, the paper depends on the paper.tech and on the figures. And I build it with pdflatex on the first prerequisite, which is the paper.tech. The figure 1 I make from the summary 1, the figure 2 from summary 2, the summary 1.dat from all the data 1 files, and the summary 2 from all the data 2 files. But I still write things multiple times. Up here, that we will get fixed now. Down there, that's what we will fix later. And we're still missing that it also depends on the Python scripts we have, stats.py and plot.py. So let's fix the first redundancy, or the first problem, namely the plot.py and the stats.py has to be added to the dependency, because if I change the plot script or if I change the stats script, then I have to redo all the figures, right? So let me just add it to the list of dependencies. What will happen is that it will not work anymore. Why will it not work? Is simply because now it calls the stats.py with all the prerequisites, and that includes stats.py. So when I call this, then the dollar caret is now stats.py, data 1, data 2, and so on. But it should not call it with the stats.py as an argument. It shouldn't call stats.py with summary and stats.py. That shouldn't be read. So I can now change my script or program to just ignore if the name of the script or program appears on the command line, but that's an ugly hack that we don't want to use. So the better one is we can make the data files depend on stats.py. I can add another dependency that says that the data files depend on stats.py. Okay, why would they depend on it? But what that does is, if stats.py changes, and stats.py is newer than the data files, then I'm calling touch. The touch will update the timestamp on the data files, and now the data files are newer than the summary files, and now the rule up there kicks in, and I'm going to rebuild the summary file. It's an ugly hack, but it's when the stats file changes, then I'm going to just make sure that the summaries get out of date. Do you like that hack? It's okay, but if we can do it better, let's do it better. Let's try. The better way is, okay, is so this. Is just not nice because we really had to make it depend on the things. The nicer one is the following. And that's again a special feature of the language, of the make language. I write here that, so I keep that the same. So summary 1.that depends on, no, wait. I messed this up when writing it. Sorry, can you please correct this on the slide? This was nonsense. Because now the summary 1.data up here depends only on the data files, and I'm calling the stats script with just the inputs. And then I'm going to add another dependency further down. The summary 1.that also depends on stats.py, but there's no action associated with it. So I can have multiple lines that list dependencies. Summary 1.that and summary 2.that depend on the data files, and here's the action using all of the inputs. But in addition, I say that summary 1.that also depends on this. And that works because the full set of dependencies is the union of all the lists that is given. But up here, the dollar caret is still only the list given up here. So now the summary 1.that depends on all the data 1 files and on the stat script. But when I call stats.py here, then the dollar caret is only the list here. Now I want to go further. I have this figure 1 and figure 2, and I duplicated that as well. What can we do here? So because that's how we look so far, we have the figure 1 PDF and figure 2 PDF depends on the summary 1.that and summary 2.that. The 1.that depends on the data 1 files, the 2.that on the data 2 files, and both of those depend on stats.py. Do you like this? You should scream now, you should say, no, I hate it, because you use copy and paste. And we want to get rid of this first redundancy here. And here's how we can do that. We can do that using pattern rules. We can tell make how to make any file that is of the form figure something PDF. So this figure dash percentage mark dot PDF will match any file of the form figure then something then PDF. And this depends on a file called summary something dot that. And it's the same pattern is used here. So figure1.pdf depends on summary1.that, figure2.pdf depends on summary2.that, and so on. And the rule is here, just use the plot.py. And I can then use the same for the stats. So that way I get rid of copying and pasting. And it works when I add a figure3.pdf and a figure4.pdf. So we run that, and it works. But it only built the first one. It only built the summary 1.that. Do you know why? Again, because we didn't have our all statement in there. Just built it. So this builds the first one. This figure percentage of PDF does not match all, but it finds the first one that matches, and the first one is built. The first one here is the summary 1.that. That's being built. And not more. It doesn't build the figure, because this is not the rule. So to fix that, we can add So this means it can use this rule, but we have to tell it what to do. Oh, I changed to PDFs. So what we have to do now is we have to put back in the statement what it should actually build, and the first target has to be the final thing you want to build, or the old thing or so. So here I put in the paper.pdf, depends on the paper.tech file, and on the figure files, and it builds it using LaTeX and the figures, and then it uses that rule here to make the figures. This doesn't work. You can't just tell it to depend on figure star.pdf. And the reason is simply that when I start with the directory, I have not created any figure yet. So there is no figure yet, and so figure star.pdf doesn't match anything, and so no figure gets built. So we have to really explicitly write out which figures it depends on here. Now we look down here, there's still duplicated code. Summary1.that and summary2.that, and we need to get rid of that. So we can do the same. We can just make such a rule that the summary percentage.that depends on data percentage star.that. The percentage mark is the make wildcard that tells, okay, this is the rules that make will match to build something. The star is, this is not important that I fix this on the display. I think it should be okay in the printed version. And this is the shell wildcard. So the summary 1.that will depend on data 1 star.that. Summary 2.that will depend on data 2 star.that. And that works. But now we're missing the dependency on stats.py. Can we put that up there? We can't put it up here. Can we put it down there? No, we cannot add a second rule. So how do we put back in the dependency on stats.py? It only uses the first rule. So the only way to put it back is either we can put it back in a dependency up here, but then it messes up the command line, then we have to hack around it, that's bad. But we can use the other hack that when stats.py changes, then it should touch all of the data files. That was the other ugly hack, but I think that's the cleanest thing to do. Or you improve make and invent your own language around that, but that's what you must do in make. So there's nothing else we can do here. It's less than perfect. So that's what it now looked like. It became pretty short now, right? And pretty compact. The paper.pdf depends on the tag files and the figures. A figure depends on the summary and gets made with a plot, and the summary depends on the data file and this made with the stats.py. But now, I use that on the machine in the lecture hall somewhere, or in the physics 6 building or somewhere. But now I go home. And at home, my things are elsewhere. At home, I have to type use a local bin PDF LaTeX or use a local bin Python. At work, I type something else, because my commands are elsewhere or called differently or whatever. What do I do now? I can write two make files. That's not only writing, it's not just copying and pasting, but it's writing and maintaining to make files. When I change one, I have to change the other. That's ugly. We said never copy anything, because it's a nightmare to maintain. And we have to do it consistently every time. We can comment and uncomment the lines in the code. We can make one line for this and one for the other. When I'm here, I comment out one. When I go home, I change it, comment out the other. I have to do it the right lines every time. That is ugly. And every time I push it to Git, it's a new version. And there's just lots of noise in there of the makefile is changing all the time. That's ugly. So we want to refactor it. We want to split things. What we're going to do is we're going to use macros. Like you can say, the LaTeX command is here, and the Python command is there. And then I'm using them down there. Here it's defined, and here it's used, the LaTeX and the Python command. So it's only one place in the file that I have to change, and not in every single rule I have to change it, but only at the top where the macros are defined. I have to change only one thing, so it's consistent throughout now, but I still have the noise in the repository. Another thing to remember is in the shell, typically a macro is used by $ and then the variable name. Here, for the macros to be used, it has to be a $ surrounded by curly braces or round braces. If you just write the $ macro, then it just thinks that you have a macro called M, which is typically empty, and then it's just acro. That's just another thing to learn about make. So, and now, what we're going to do to solve the problem that we had is we're going to put the macros that define all of the system-specific things into a separate file, which we call here config.mk. There, right, my LaTeX is here, my Python is here, my C++ compiler is there, my libraries are located here, the compiler flags are here, and so on. So all the things that depend on the system go into a separate config file, where you specify all the macros. And then in the main makefile that you have, you include that config file. So you type include config.mk. And now we have separated the system-specific parts from the makefile that builds my project. So here, I'm going to include things, and that's what I'm going to use. That way, we're nearly there, because now when I change the config.mk, then at least there's no change in the makefile, and the makefile stays nice and clean in the Git repository. But it's still ugly, because I'm still changing that file. And so the solution here now is an elegant one. I'm actually going to create two or three or four configuration files, one for each system where I work on. I make a config home where I put in the paths for my system at home. I put in a config lab where I put the commands for the lab. And I might do a config work, and a config here, and a config there. Multiple config files. And these two files I put into the version control into the Git repository. But my make file that I used to build it only depends on a file called config.mk. And that I don't put in, but then I copy the one for the specific machine to a file called config.mk. So in the repository, there are both files, config home and config lab. When I work in the lab, I copy the config lab.mk to a local file called config.mk, and at home I copy the other. And that is the file being used. So we copy this, and in the lab we copy the other, and then that's the file that is being used for the makefile. But that config.mk you don't put into version control. That way you solved it in a nice way. There are many other approaches. There's things like CMake and AutoConf and others. They typically convert something into a make file on Unix. CMake is nice, and we learned that in 2 weeks, because CMake is a tool that on Unix allows you to create a make file, that on the Mac allows you to create either a make file or an Xcode project, and that on Windows allows you to, from the same build file, to create a Visual Studio project. So while make, what I showed you now, works only on Linux and Unix, CMake will work also on Windows, and the same build file works on Windows as well. Is anybody here who wants to compile on Windows? If not, then you should just remember that. In some years, we have people who want to use it, then you CMake. Or if you want to write a program that somebody else might want to run on Windows, then you CMake. This is a bit easier sometimes, but it's even harder to debug and use it. So first try and learn make, and that's where I want to stop. What you should have learned is how make is used. What you should do for the homework is you should try to use make to automatically build your library. Think about how can you set up a make file that when you change the header file, Simpson.h recompiles all parts. When you just change the implementation of Simpson, Simpson.cpp recompiles only Simpson.cpp and then relinks the program. When you change only your main program, it recompiles only the main program but not the library. So try to make a make file that only builds what you need. And always remember, build file is basically a program, and so you have to think about it carefully, you have to debug it carefully, you should put it into the Git repository, and you have to just learn that programming language called make. Okay. Let's stop here. The example files are in the Git repository of the lecture, where you can simply get it, and with the make files and all. The make files, the scripts, that's in there.